Yeah, we're just kind of setting the stage. I'm really happy to have Steve Sandberg on the show today. How's it going, Steve?
Hey, good. It's great to be here.
Yeah, great to have you. You've had quite a career, played with a lot of great people, made a lot of great music, and been alongside so many wonderful people and got so many influences. So I'm excited about the new album that you brought, and also to hear all this great music. So where do you want to start?
Yeah, I don't know. I was so glad you told me like 20 minutes before the show started to bring some music. So that's cool. I got a playlist together real quick.
Cool.
So that's cool. But yeah, that stuff you played was so beautiful, and
Oh.
that's a big influence on me. I grew up playing classical piano. It's my first thing, and then when I was around 17, I really got into Latin music. And I
Right.
was living in the city. I used to listen to Felipe Luciano's radio show. And just heard those rhythms, and it was just completely captivated. And luckily, I was in the epicenter of this scene when it was happening. And I moved to back to New York in the late 70s and played with a lot of salsa bands, in the Corso and a lot of these people and a lot of these groups back then. It was so the classical stuff and the world music stuff really kind of came together for me from a pretty
Right.
early
So
age.
1970s New York, was it mostly jazz clubs or is it dance clubs that you're
At my
playing?
particular thing, I was playing in salsa bands and charanga bands at the time. Yeah, so it was the Corso, it was all kinds of clubs in Washington Heights. It was Pozos, which would open up at 4 a.m. and close at about 8 a.m., where all the musicians would hang out afterwards.
And how what were the size of the ensembles usually?
I don't know, maybe, I guess it was a piano bass, congas, timbal, flute, violin, three singers, somebody playing guido. So they were a little larger than a jazz quartet.
Right, and most people people were dancing most of the
Oh
time?
yeah. Oh yeah. And I love that. I love that. And I used to be part of the Salsa Meets Jazz series at the Village Gate too, which was amazing. Yeah, they would have bring salsa bands in and pair them with great jazz artists. So I got to play with James Moody. I got to play in a two piano band with McCoy Tyner, which was unbelievable. But the really great thing about it was to play music while people were dancing, which I think is really where it's at. And I had one experience there that I'll never forget. I think I was playing with Papo Vasquez's band, and I was playing a piano solo, and you're just watching everybody dance while you were playing. All of a sudden, I just really got into the flow of it, and in the same millisecond that I started really playing well, the whole dance floor changed. And people grabbed each other tighter, people got lower to the ground. It all happened as one thing, and I was very grateful to be able to experience that as kind of harking back to the early days of jazz where music was danceable.
And I'm just so curious about that time. So, in typical places, that the dance floor would have how many people? 50, 100 people out
Well, I
there, or
mean, it all
20, or
depends. It all depends. I mean, I remember the Corso was kind of the big club that we played at. It was on 86, I think, at Third Avenue. And I'm bad at estimating crowds. I can't quite tell you what the capacity was, but it was larger. But then there were a lot of, very often we'd go out to New Jersey and play a wedding, right? We get there at like 10 p.m., play a wedding till about 1:30, come into the city, play at the Corso, which had maybe a couple of hundred people, I don't know, and then go play at Pozos afterwards till 8 in the morning, where all the musicians were hanging. Yeah, they had like big roulette wheels set up. It was like really
It
something.
was a scene.
Yeah.
Those were the days.
Mm-hmm.
Awesome. All right, so what were we gonna set the stage with
Yeah,
here?
well, since we're talking about those days, let's play a track. Here, let me pass you my playlist. What was that? Voices.
That was in your head. Oh, that mazurka is that, or was that?
No, yo, that's the later.
Okay.
Why don't you put on Eddie Palmieri, Malao para o Sapo.
All right. Anything we should know about this before I put it on?
Yeah, it's great.
Okay. Let's check it out. Wow.
That's got Barry Rogers on trombone. You know, mm-hmm. Barry was a phenomenon at that time. And he was like me, a Jewish guy who got into Latin music. And it was definitely a big connection there.
Oh, between the two of you or between Jewish people?
Well, I did know Barry, but also just Jewish people in Latin music.
Really? I've heard the mambo, like Jews love the mambo. But what are the other connections?
What's the connection? Well, first of all, Jewish people love it. I mean, a lot of these bands would go up and play in the Catskills. My theory is also that, you know, in the minor key stuff, the Wawako stuff, there's a big, you know, they use the harmonic minor scale a lot. There's that influence from the Moorish side of Spain, and so that is a Semitic kind of singing in the vocal. Like, you hear that in a lot of Cuban wawanko.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, very cool. Yeah, I've had guys who, like flamenco musicians, tell me that, I guess it was under the Inquisition, that this... all these different influences got frozen together, including the Jewish cantorial and the Moroccan, and all these different kind of rhythms got combined into kind of this one aesthetic.
Yeah. Well,
this
comes into what I was saying before. I believe everything is world music, including classical, you know, what we call Western classical music. It all comes from somewhere. And also, there's nothing pure.
Right.
There's really nothing pure. I've studied North Indian vocal music a bit, and I was really looking for the purest music. And my teacher sang some Nomptom Alap, right? And I was freaking out. I was like, oh my God, this is it. I found it. There is nothing purer than this. And I asked him what the syllables were, and he said, oh, this is a combination of when the Moors invaded India, we didn't want to offend them by singing the Hindu ragas, so we kind of mispronounced them on purpose. Plus, some of the Moors people like the mantras, not right, the mantras. Some of the Moors people like the mantras, so they would sang them, but with an accent. So that's what this music is.
Right, right. Interesting, yeah. Yeah, the North Indian particularly has that whole, all the Mughal emperors and the Persian influence. Cool. So, I mean, that was a pretty fiery place to start. Where else are we going from here?
Well, you want to play? Why don't you play a cut that I played piano on from that time, from Nestor Torres, who was
You're at WKCR, the home of technical difficulties.
Okay, yeah. Here we go.
Okay.
Nestor was he's living in Miami now, and he's a wonderful flutist. And we were kind of starting out both at that time. He did an album. It's going to be a soul seco. We did an album called No Me Provoques, which was half very kind of traditional charanga music, where his dad played piano. His dad was a fabulous salsa pianist. And this particular cut was something that I wrote. And it's called Azul Seco, Dry Blue. And Nestor overdubbed three flutes on it. You know, it was very much kind of from the jazz at that time, kind of like Coltrane-y harmonies, 12-8 Afro rhythm. And it was a great band. I don't remember everyone on it, but Andy Gonzalez was on bass, Nestor overdubbed flutes, Papo Vasquez on trombone, I was on piano, and some other heavyweights that I cannot remember.
And charanga, what's like the definition, or like how do you describe that?
Charanga music is you know, with, we've got a Latin rhythm section and basically violins and flute.
Okay.
And it's just a wonder, it's such a happy sound, you know. We've kind of lost that happiness in our culture, I think. Everything's gotten pretty dark. But at that time, this is one of the things I love living in New York. I used to live up on 108th Street. People would be driving by in their cars, and you'd hear this amazing music with... In fact, before you play Nestor's Cut, why don't you play some charanga music? I brought some stuff from Ritmo Oriental from Cuba. And it's not New York charanga music, but it's kind of the roots of it. And there's a track called Una Descarga Cual.
Okay, I'm looking for it. Una des- got it.
Yeah.
Okay, so this is
Orquesta Ritmo Oriental.
Okay, so they're from the Orient.
They're from Cuba.
Yeah.
zagane ni clavo la varilla.
Nice track. That was awesome. So that was the aforementioned track with Steve Sandberg on keys and
Nestor Torres. Yeah. It was Nestor Torres' record, No Me Provoques.
Wow.
I think Nestor's coming back to New York. He used to live here. He's been in Miami. I saw him recently. He played at Birdland with his group and said he's going to be teaching at the new school. So we're looking forward to having him on the scene here.
Yeah. Yeah. And did you write that or you just...
I did.
Yeah, awesome. Wow. Super cool track, man.
Thank you.
Smoking. So when you first entered the Latin scene, was there any challenges coming from the classical background, like just having to vamp so hard and all this kind of stuff, or was it just you just hopped right in there?
Well, I kind of had a feel for it, but at the same time, I think there are challenges for anyone. I didn't start improvising at all till I was 17. I played the piano starting when I was 4.
Right.
And I think there are big challenges for anyone who starts improvising, you know, it comes from a classical background.
Yeah.
You know, namely that when you learn classical music, you're learning through the eye. Mm-hmm. And it kind of, you know, piano kind of goes from the eye to the fingers and unfortunately can bypass the ear for a lot of people with that kind of training. And the rhythm thing, the improvisation thing, the listening thing, the playing with other people is really... could be foreign territory, you know. So I feel like it really took me kind of a lifetime to catch up.
Right. Well, it seems like you got there. You seem pretty comfortable now in just about any, in a lot of settings with such a wide scope of influences and so on.
Yeah, but, you know, it's a lifelong work.
Yeah. Cool. Well, where should we go from here? I mean, do you want to check out the new record, or is there something that
I
you want to play
actually,
first?
I do, actually, because there's a cut on it. It's the last cut on the album. It's called Black Ivory, and I actually wrote it around this time, and it kind of sat in my closet for a long time. And I actually recorded it back then. I had a group with Robbie Amin, a drummer who's a fabulous drummer on the scene, plays with Eddie Palmieri and a million people. And... we had a little group with Lincoln Goins, and Barry Rogers actually produced a little demo that we did at the time.
Cool.
And we did this track, and, you know, when I put my new group together, which we could talk about, that's this group that really has influences from every kind of music that I've ever been involved in. This is the only composition from the past that I trotted out, and it's very Afro-Cuban, but it's in 7/8.
Interesting.
Much of it. So it's got this kind of Balkan influence, too.
Wow. What track number is this?
Number 8, okay. Black Ivory.
All right, here we go. Wow. More heat here. That was incredible, man. It's so rare, like, a lot of times when musicians, maybe they just say, okay, I want to do something in seven. They start with the math or something like that, and then they try to fit the groove in, and sometimes it doesn't, it doesn't groove, but that was smoking. Like, I think your average person wouldn't even have known that there was actually some kind of tricky stuff going on.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Well, that's what I think what music should be. I think it, you know, I'm so into dancing, and I think it should be body, it should be dancing, it should be, and that's what, you know, if you study the traditions that these rhythms come from, there's a logic to it, you know, and I really started to understand the odd meter thing when I was at a klezmer camp. And I saw Polish people dancing traditional Polish dances in odd meters. And I got it. It's like, oh, they don't count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. They count short, short, long, short, short, long, short, short, long. And the long is when they jump off the ground. So there's a little beat before you come down. So it's physical.
Wow. Yeah. Yeah, it's interesting how much anxiety musicians can develop around what is basically very simple stuff, because, you know, I know it took me years, and I guess still sometimes if I know something is in not a meter that I grew up with, that I have a fear and trembling set in, when really, you know, it's like step, step, jump.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it does take a lot of study before you're really comfortable
Can you relax in it?
I've spent many hours with Drum Genius working on my sevens.
Yeah, well, it sounds so free, and it sounds like everybody in the band also is not counting taka 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 taka. You know, it just feels like everybody is.
I don't think so. By the way, I'm so privileged to have these musicians to work with. This band came together about a year and a half ago, when I was at a time in my life where I just wanted to try something new, and I had always had this idea to do a concert where I'd play straight classical music for the first half, and then get a band together and write original tunes, many of which would be based on the classical tunes with world music rhythms. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I was just like, well, let me try it. So Scott Albertson at Project 142, you know, gave us an opportunity to play at the Domena Center. And it really worked. And the funny thing about it was so organic. I mean, I think I started with Haydn, and there was Chopin, and there was Bartok, and there was Ravel. And then there was this group, and it didn't feel like an anomaly or like we were trying to make some kind of intellectual point. It just kind of worked, and that's been the whole impetus behind this project.
Nice. All right, well, what you got lined up? I know you got some.
I'd like to play. Well, first of all, I want to do a shout-out to the musicians playing. We've got the really extraordinary Zach Brock on violin, and I've just been so blessed to meet Zach and to be able to play with him. He plays a lot with Snarky Puppy, and he plays with Phil Markowitz. He's got his own group, Triptych, which I'd love to play a cut from later.
What's instrument is he on?
He's a violinist.
Violinist, okay.
And I mean, it's really, he's unique. He's classically trained. He's from Appalachia, so he's got kind of a roots background in that. He plays jazz. Actually, I don't, he plays jazz. He's incredible with all these rhythms, and really dedicated to the music. So it's been a big honor to work with Zach. And Michael O'Brien on bass, just really, really solid and there, and with a beautiful, beautiful tone and intonation and sound. Mm-hmm. And Mauricio Zottarelli from Brazil on the drums. Again, just a sweet guy, an absolute virtuoso, and someone who's really, I think, really kind of created a whole other concept for this music. You know, one of the interesting things about this album is I played it for a friend of mine who's a bata drummer, and he heard bata in everything. Mm. And he said, you could put bata on this. And so Mauricio is so solid that he's incorporating Brazilian rhythms, Cuban rhythms and stuff, but doing like a Tony Williams thing where he's just so free with it, where he's playing around it.
Wow.
But, you know,
next level.
The bass is solid, yeah. And our producer was Sandro Albert, who's a fabulous Brazilian guitarist and producer who really lifted the record up. Okay, well, I'd like to play another cut from the record. The first cut is called Janos, but actually first, I like to play something from a part of the world that, you know, influenced it. And this particular cut is an original composition. It's in seven, mostly in seven. There's some five in it. But it is based on the second of Bartok's three folk songs from the County of Chick, which I didn't bring with me. But I did bring a song called Molita from Village Music of Bulgaria. When I was around 15, Nonsuch was coming out with these world music records that I was just enchanted with. And so in addition to the Latin music, I was listening to this music, which is just incredible beauty.
All right.
So we're going to hear Molita and then Janos.
All right. So some traditional Bulgarian music here for you folks. And then we're going to go right into the album. Is that the plan?
Yeah.
Awesome. And then we'll hear more from Steve Sandberg's new album.
Thank you.
new music from our guest Steve Sandberg. The album is called Alaya. It's out on Artist Share. People are loving it. I'm loving it. It's really, you know, it's nice. It kind of shows you that you can create something new and fresh and original, and it can still be joyful, you know. And I think it's nice to hear that.
Thank you.
Preserved. So, yeah. And I guess that had some Balkan influence.
Absolutely. The rhythms. And I think I did something that they don't do in traditional Balkan music, though I'm no expert. There's mostly in seven, these little jumps in five.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah.
Cool. All right, so.
So this is a shout out to our amazing violinist, soloist, Zach Brock, and he's got a group called Triptych. And we're going to play something called Nightshade that he asked me to play. And he asked me to say it was recorded with one mic. It's a live performance. I think his group also has a lot of classical and world music influence. I think this also has a lot of Balkan influence.
All right, sweet. I'm psyched for this. Thank you. Right, music from Zach Brock here on WKCR. Our very special guest is Steve Sandberg. I'm so glad you came through. And it's often people say such interesting things when the mics are off. So I would just appreciate if you could, you're making a really interesting point about biology and healing music and certain, maybe you could just give a sense of what were you getting at.
Well, I think music, I personally like music that's uplifting in a way, and I think that there's a function with our consciousness, and I just happened to be listening to a YouTube video of, I forget his name, a neurosurgeon who had a very intense near-death experience, and he kind of went to a kind of heavenly-like place. He wrote a book about it, and sound was very, very important in it, and sound was kind of a cue to certain states of consciousness. And I've had experiences myself with African healing substances and techniques, and sound is a huge part of it, and rhythm is a huge part of it. So I don't think sound is neutral, and I think it's something that's not often talked about, you know. And I think I prefer to create kind of a joyous sound. I mean, certainly there's a lot of room for strife and sadness and expression of those things in music, but I don't know. I prefer to create a kind of sound that's was going to uplift us and going to express certain emotions. That's what I love about world music, that Bulgarian thing we listen to. It's so keyed to human emotion. So I like to stay very grounded.
Yeah. Yeah, really great. So actually, speaking of your African influences, we're going to hear a track called Iboga.
Yeah.
Anything we should know before we jump in on this?
Well, it's rhythmically based on the rhythm of the Iboga is an African plant medicine, very powerful, and it's used in the Bwiti religion in Gabon, and I believe it was discovered by the Pygmies in Africa. There's a rhythm and instruments that go with it. The mouth bow is used with it, and sticks, and there's certain rhythm, which is actually very kind of similar to the Gnawa music we were talking about, is the basis of it. So this is just a piece based on that rhythm and my feelings about Iboga.
Wow. You know, before we jump in, I mean, that's interesting that the Gnawa thing is similar, because I feel that a lot of music that's used for journeying, a lot of it, it seems like the polyrhythms or the implied polyrhythms are like the technology.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. One more thing I read about that was that the listening to this the other day, that the actual tempo of the music in much journey in music is associated with the state of mind, the brainwave frequency of the infant. And the thing about the infant is the infant perceives information without reference to the past, the way a child does.
Wow.
So it's very tied in with reprogramming.
Uh-huh. It's a pretty fast tempo? Or do you know?
I can't give you the numbers. Yeah, yeah. Not that kind of guy.
All right. So here's the track Iboga.
Iboga.
Of the Steve Sandberg Quartet's new album, Alaya.
Thank you. with the mother of dreams. She said, I respect you, but you got a demon on your back you don't even know. But I know this guy down in Chinatown who can help you. Who can help you? Who can help you? I was playing with the mother of dreams. She said, it's time for show and tell. But a zookeeper brought out this animal. At first I thought it was a snake. It was beautiful. Its back the color of Pueblo earth and wine red sky. But it had vampire teeth and four stunted little legs. And it could fly like a dragon. She said, when you get scared, it gets scared. When you settle down, it gets quiet. It can help you. It can help you. It can help you. I was flying with the mother of dreams. She said, I can tell your fortune now, but I'm not playing. You gotta meet me more than halfway. Take your mind off that crap. And look up. Afterwards, the boy lay cradled in his lover's arms. His daddy said, I don't buy it, but I know you are a healer. I can help you. I can help you. I can help you.
Music of today, music recorded this year by the Steve Sandberg Quartet. The album's called Alaya, and we just heard two tracks. We heard Iboga and Annie. And
Annie.
Mm-hmm. Is that a person?
Yeah, that's based on one day I woke up and for some reason I turned to the obituary page of the New York Times, and there was a picture of a clown. And I was just really taken by the picture. And her name was Annie Fratellini. And over the years, I researched her. And it turned out she was came from a family of Italian-French circus clowns. And every year from her second birthday, her father gave her a different musical instrument as a present.
Nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, clowning is pretty serious business, actually, they say.
Yeah.
Yeah, they got some rigorous training and all that stuff. Should the next DJ show up, then it would follow that we would only have time for just one more, although you never know at WKCR. So, where do you think we should go from here? Anything else?
I think we should play What Reason Could I Give by Ornette Coleman.
Okay.
Because it's so incredibly beautiful.
Sounds good to me. And definitely territory we didn't quite touch upon.
It's just, you know, pure beauty. By the way, there's an Indian singer. This is one of the few tracks Ornette did with a vocalist. And it's an Indian singer whose name escapes me at the moment. But I met them, actually, when she and her husband were in New York in the late 70s, early 80s. And they knew a lot about raga. And they also had the top disco band in Bombay.
Wow.
Yeah, at the time.
All right. Well, let's check it out. And then we'll either say goodbye or keep the good music coming.
Cool.
Here we go. Thanks for that, Steve. That was awesome.
Thanks for having me. It's been a pleasure.
Ending to the show. You said you're feeling good about things. We're headed in a good direction.
With the band? Yeah, we just played at Birdland. We had a great show there. We might be, Jack and I might open up for Bebe Gilberto at City Winery in December. We're still waiting to hear on that. And if not, playing Side Door Cafe in Old Lyme, we're next thing in New York that's definite is the Domenica Center in June, but we're going to be lining up stuff. So if you go to stevesandbergmusic.com, you could see where we're going to be playing.
All right. Congrats on the new album. And I guess at this point, we're going to move over to